Before I start my talk, I am really very happy that this atmosphere of brotherhood, it has really moved me. And I will request Dr. Zakir Naik to come forward and let's have a gale lag ja scene. The chief guest of this morning, Mr. Y.P. Trivedi, President of Rushabh Corporation, Sri Dhanraj Salecha, the learned speaker, Dr. Zakir Naik, the expert commentator and the coordinator, Dr. Mohammad Naik, Vice President of IBC, Sri Chaman Bhai Vora, other dignitaries on and off the dais, my friends, brothers and sisters. First of all, I must acknowledge the dedication, the sincerity with which all the three organizations, particularly Islam Research Foundation, has taken pains in arranging this lecture. I don't mind and I don't hesitate in saying the entire credit goes to IRF. Friends, the topic today is non-veg food permitted or prohibited for a human being? Any argument or any statement for that matter is always to be considered from a relative point of view. There cannot be any absolute truth, there cannot be any absolute statement that it is 100% prohibited or 100% permitted. So friends, let's see, as very rightly put in by Mr. Trivedi who started the ball rolling, that we will not speak only from religious point of view. Religious has to enter. You can't divorce it from today's subject. But I would like to speak on this topic, that non-veg food is prohibited for human being from various angles. For example, geographical reason, historical reason, moral, ethical and religious reason, economical, environmental and ecological reasons, natural reasons and psychological reasons, and above all, medical reasons. It's a fact now well established that our actions are controlled by our thoughts. What we think, we act. And our thoughts are controlled by our diet. As we eat, so we behave. And that's why the topic is very important, that we should choose our diet in such a way that our thinking is positive. The word positive will include everything. And believe me friends, not only all the religions, but the medical science has now proved that the food that we take, it definitely influences our thinking and so our behavior. Friends, there was a time when there was no alternative available, as Mr. Trivedi rightly put. There were places on this world, and there are even now places where there is no availability of vegetation. It is simply not possible. because of the extreme circumstances. But now the world has progressed so much that there is a very advanced system of transportation which is available to us, and any type of commodity including food can be transported from one part of the globe to another without any problem. Now that when we have got alternatives, we have to think about this, which alternative is better from all the angles that which I have described earlier. And that's why, friends, I am now coming to my topic proper, that non-veg food is not permitted now at this point of time, not only for India but for other countries of the world also. First of all, I will say that all Indian philosophies have stated that we should not harm any living being, not only the living beings that we can see, but also those living beings which we cannot see, which are in air, fire, water, etc. But always there is a limit. It's very difficult for a human being to refrain from total ahimsa, total hinsa or violence because of his needs. So that is why Lord Mahavir stated that at least you limit the essential killings, but absolutely no killing for your own selfish motive or for your own needs of hunger, etc. And that is why under Jainism and most of the Indian philosophies, non-veg food is totally prohibited. Now this is a religious aspect. I will not go very deep into it. But the psychological aspect, the effect that non-veg food has on our thoughts and deeds, that is the most important part. The learned authors, I will not now quote the names of the books and authors because that will take time. But I have got all the authorities with me. It is said that veg diet reduces needless suffering in the world and also preserves our ecosystem. See, when I talk about alternative, you look here, you look at the wild animals who stay in jungle. Those who are carnivorous, they will restrict themselves to meat eating only. But those animals which are herbivorous, they will never go for meat eating. Only human being is such, because of some false notions I will say, it is the human being has been both a carnivorous and herbivorous. As I said, if alternative is available, why should we go for unnecessary killing? The basic principle underlying this theory is non-violence, love and compassion for animals, birds, fish, etc. Because flesh food falls in not essential category, while vegetarian food comes under essential category. Psychologically also, cruelty, instant impulses, urges, basic animal instincts, impatience are all the necessary consequences of flesh food. By eating animal flesh, man will ingest all the animal instincts, the four basic animal instincts of food, fear, possessiveness and reproduction. These are there in men, I don't say no, but they are the basic instincts. We have got a reasoning mind. We can rise above these basic instincts. We can control our impulses and urges and become, then only we can become super animals or super beings. Otherwise, human being and animals, there is no difference at all. But man has additional quality called reasoning mind, which is blunted by the influence of flesh food, and man becomes more like animal. The scientific reason for this is that flesh is an integral part of animal body. It is full of tamasic value, There are three types of values, tamasic, rajasic and sattvic. Tamasic in short is the brutal sense or brutal instincts of animal. A man becomes more like an animal, he is callous, he is cruel, he is ignorant, if he is eating the food that is the part of the bodies of the dead animals. The crime rate is higher, aggression in the natural is the natural consequences of flesh food. It distorts the thinking and reasoning. It is not only a problem by itself, but it creates many other problems like increase in crimes, cruelty, etc. The virtues like compassion, sharing, self-control are obliterated by the impact of flesh food. If we insist on treating animals more brutally, then our behavior will also become less human and more brutal. I will quote one shayari that what will happen if this animal instincts is so embedded in our heart, what will become of man? Aadmi ki shakl se ab dar raha hai aadmi. Aadmi ki shakl se ab dar raha hai aadmi. Aadmi ko loot kar ghar bhar raha hai aadmi. Aadmi hi marta hai mar raha hai aadmi. Aadmi hi marta hai mar raha hai aadmi. Samajh kuch aata nahi kya kar raha hai aadmi. Friends, this is because the man has become an animal. He does not then distinguishes between whether he is an animal or a human being, because this is the influence of the food, the flesh food that he eats. Flesh food is the cause of PMS syndrome, that is preposterous mood swing and psychological distortions. Thus, it is now established that if flesh food is the root cause of moral and spiritual degeneration. We at Indian Vegetarian Congress, we are working for important task, since it will lead to a more humane world at peace with animal kingdom and with each other. We at IBC define a vegetarian as one who does not at any time or under any circumstances eat meat, fish, fowl, eggs or any other type of flesh food. Vegetarian does not come from vegetable. Now this is very important, friends, understand. The word vegetarian does not come from vegetable. The root is derived from the word vegetus, V-E-G-E-T-U-S, meaning whole, sound, fresh, lively. Nothing is more powerful than an individual acting out of his conscience, thus helping to bring the collective conscience to life. That is what Norman Cousin said. And what does Albert Schweitzer has to say? Until man extends his circle of compassion to all living things, man will not find peace for himself. It is a man's sympathy with all creatures that first makes him truly a human being. Now, friends, I will go next to the most important topic, and that is the medical viewpoint. It's a fallacy, friend. It's a myth to say that we don't get enough protein from veg food. And that is why a man must have flesh food that is rich in protein. I'll come one by one to these myths. First of all, I will first give you examples of those strong animals, say elephant, say rhino. These are the strongest animals on this earth. Are they meat eaters? No. They are pure veg. Even if they die, they will not eat meat. Even then, they are the strongest. Take example of horse. We talk about horse power. It's the most powerful creature, useful for our purpose, and that is also a pure vegetarian. And take examples of cattle, cows, bullock, and other animals. They are not only useful to us, but they are pure vegetarian. My point here is that those vegetarian animals are strong enough and they don't need any flesh food. In fact, if stupidly flesh food is given to these veg animals, what will happen? You all know about the mad cow disease, the syndrome called BEC. Friends, this BSE, bovine spongiform encephalopathy, you know what happened a few years back in England? It was a result of feeding rendered sheep byproducts to cattle as protein supplement. These sheep were infected with scrapie, an SE disease known for over 200 years. Now, if sheep food can make a cow mad, what do you expect the result on human being? Millions of innocent cows were killed mercilessly just because they were suspected to be infected with BSE, and that too for no fault of theirs, but the stupid ways of feeding sheep protein on absolutely unnatural diet for a cow. So is the case with humans. Animal protein is not natural for us. Similarly, millions of chicks were destroyed in Eastern Asia countries because they were infected with certain disease. Now coming back to healthy diet, I will quote from one Dr. Dean Ornish, who has written a very learned book on how to reverse heart disease without surgery or drugs. And this book, my friends, is the best seller in America now. It has really created interest in the people of America and all over the world for that matter, that veg food is definitely better from medical point of view. He has given two types of diet, one reversal and one prevention of heart disease. Both are strictly veg diets because he has proved scientifically that veg food is the best food for a human being. It not only helps heart patients but also reduces risk of other degenerating and fatal diseases caused by flesh food, diseases like cancers of colon, cancers of breast, cancers of prostate, obesity, high blood pressure, stroke, diabetes, gallstones. The Surgeon General of America has confirmed this in the report on nutrition and health. He has given certain facts for protein. Friends, we'll have to be a little technical about it. The protein is formed from building blocks called amino acids. These are of million varieties, of which only three are critical for us: lysine, tryptophan, and methionine. All these are available in animals as well as veg, plant food. But when one consumes animal food for getting these three critical amino acids, one also consumes unnecessary elements like cholesterol, saturated fat. Friends, these are the two things that are the prime reason, the killers for human being: cholesterol and saturated fat. Now let us address the issue that is universally put forward, that we do not get sufficient protein from vegetarian food, and so we have to turn to flesh food for adequate supply of amino acids. Now this is a fallacy. A combined meal of legumes and cereals — legumes means dal, pulses, and cereals mean wheat, rice, etc. You have to combine these two and you get a complete balanced diet which provides complete protein, which is not different from protein found in eggs or meat, but without cholesterol and animal instincts. One dietic association has stated positive relationship between vegetable lifestyles and risk reduction for several chronic degenerative diseases, as mentioned earlier. It has confirmed that veg diet is healthier and more nutritious. Plant food is totally free from cholesterol, which is only found, which is found in both. But cholesterol is only found in animal products such as meat, poultry, fish, and dairy. Flesh food is also high in saturated fats, which our liver converts into cholesterol. Our body makes all the cholesterol we need. Now this is very important, friends. You must understand, we need cholesterol, but we don't have to take cholesterol from animal food. Our body, it's a wonderful mechanism. The biochemistry, the chemical factory of our body can manufacture all proteins, all cholesterol from our own system. 3/4 of the cholesterol in our blood is made by our body. It is the excessive amounts of cholesterol and saturated fat in the diet that lead to coronary heart disease. The other diseases, friends, which I have summarized from various journals, medical journals: epilepsy, infected flesh, kidney diseases, excessive protein, excessive uric acid. These are all the diseases because of the flesh food. Rheumatoid, arthritis, gout. This is the direct consequence of uric acid found in flesh food. Degeneration of intestines, decay in immunity system. Dr. Deepak Chopra of America has stated that our body is capable of living for more than 100 years if we take proper care of it. Now look at the population in north, extreme north region, Eskimos. Now perforce, because no vegetation is available, they have to take flesh food. And the average life of an Eskimo is only 30 years. All non-veg food is devoid of vitamin C and vitamin A, which is naturally available in vegetables. Avidin in eggs and other dangerous bacteria are responsible for many skin diseases such as eczema, scabies, leprosy, etc. Now I'll give you a certain scientific facts. One medical study has proved that there are less heart diseases in veg people than flesh eaters. It's a well-known fact that not only in India, but even in advanced countries, there is no foolproof system of medical exam of animals before slaughtering. Thus, diseases carried by them are passed on to the humans who eat flesh food. Friends, we all know that like human beings, the animals are also infected by diseases. And they are the carriers of the deadliest germs. And when these animals, they die and one eats that flesh, that diseases which were infected and which were the part of the dead body of that animal is again inherited by us. 9% of food poisoning cases, 90% of food poisoning cases are in flesh food eaters. When an animal or bird is brought to a slaughterhouse, now this is a friend which is again, it needs some explanation. If you have visited a slaughterhouse or a poultry, you will know this. When the animals are brought to the slaughterhouse and when they know that they are going to be slaughtered, the pain, the agony, the anguish that runs in the system, it gives rise to adrenaline, the hormones, which mixes with the blood and into the flesh. Now these instincts of fear, anguish, anger, despair, all negative points are then becoming part of the flesh food and it passes on to the person who eats. And that is why, friends, I say that when one eats flesh food, he becomes more like animal and less like a human being. I will now turn to the fallacy that eggs are necessary for growing children because they contain protein. As I said, excessive protein is more harmful than useful. And the protein that we find in pulses, in cereals, is much more richer and natural than the protein, the excessive protein we find in animal food. Now I'll give you the example of egg. Each egg weighs about 100 grams and has 170 calories. It contains 13.6% of protein, as against that any dal or pulse will contain 24% of protein, much more than the egg of same weight, 100 gram. Egg will contain 13.3% saturated fat, while there is no saturated fat or very little of 1% in cereals and pulses. 450 to 500 milligram of cholesterol is contained in egg, one egg. Amino acid called methionine, which destroys vitamin B. Large quantity of sodium salt. All these are part of the egg. And when one eats egg, he is then infected his body is infected because of this excess protein, cholesterol and saturated fat. It does not contain any carbohydrate. It does not contain any fiber. Friends, the medical science has now come forward and stated that for our digestion, we must have fiber. And fiber is found only in vegetable food and not in the flesh food at all. Now, cost-wise, I'm only comparing the egg now. Cost-wise, for 1 gram of protein, the cost of egg is 4 to 5 times more than the pulses, wheat or soybean. Cost of 100 calories, it is almost 10 times the costlier than the pulses. Thus, pulses, wheat, etc. are not only cheaper, but they provide other important nutritions like vitamins, minerals, fiber, etc. Now let's take a look at the poultry farming. Now they call it poultry farming, it's a totally misnomer. I tell you, sir, it is a poultry factory. The way in which the birds are stored there, they have to climb upon one another to eat or drink because there is not sufficient space. Even the poultry people, they say that this is our factory and these are our merchandise. They are goods, nothing but our products. We are not concerned whether they are living beings or not. They are totally devoid of any compassion, any karuna, and that is why these things are also reflected in the birds. The birds are stored like commodities. They are fed unnatural food and administered drugs which are harmful for humans only to speed up their metabolism so that they can produce more eggs. The poultry people are only interested in making profit. And the result of this, they die premature death. It affects physical as well as mental health, intellectual and emotional growth. Egg is poison for children. Egg begin to rot immediately unless they are put in deep fridge. But when they are marketed, they are prone to decay and disease faster. Vegetable egg is again a myth. It's a fallacy. No egg can be a vegetable egg. It's an animal product and animal product only. It is definitely it's definitely an animal product. It can never be called vegetable item. It's a misnomer. It's a deception. Friends, I will now turn to the economical aspect. Now these also I have studied from various journals, medical science, and more important from the statistics department of the government of India and government of America, the UK government, etc. But I will not, that's why, give you the citations during my talk, but I will give you the summary. UK. The survey has stated the land required to produce the fodders to feed the animals to obtain flesh food is 14 times more than that required for vegetable diet to feed men directly. Because what happens? First you grow fodder, you feed it to the animals, and then you kill the animals for flesh food. And that is how you get your flesh food. But if the same land is used for agriculture, for pulses and cereals, that same piece of land can support many more families, and here only few families can be supported by using this land for pasture. I have been given one statistics: 10 square acres of land can support 10 heads of human beings or 10 heads of cattle for the whole year. But 10 heads of cattle for meat cannot support even one single person throughout the year. Natural grass or pasture can, and grain crop both genetically belong to grass family. You see, once the crop is harvested, what we have is sashish or stalks. These are again the source of, excellent source of biochemical fertilizer or manure. Look how many crores of rupees of our foreign exchange we are wasting on artificial fertilizer and chemical fertilizer, which we all know is extremely harmful to us. But because we are not able to get the natural manure which we can get from cattle and animals, we are destroying them, foolishly destroying them for our own food, but we are not considering the fact that the manure that these animals produce are much more economical, much more healthier, and much more useful to our country. It's now well known fact that 16 kilogram of food grain are required to be fed to one animal for forming 1 kilogram of meat. Thus, by feeding animals reared for slaughter, the country is deprived of vital food grains which can feed many, many more people. So, not only for growing food, but also for pasture and for manure, we require land. The human oncogene work done by Professor Wilbing from Massachusetts, it has stated that to obtain 1 calorie of animal flesh, 7 vegetable calories have to be spent. And the study further shows that the land needed to graze 1 average animal can sustain 5 average families. I will not burden you with facts and figures, but the summary of all this is that it is very economical to feed people on veg diet rather than on flesh food. Now let's take the other point of view of economy, ecology, environment, slaughterhouses, etc. Production of animal flesh food require more land, more water, more food grains for feeding animals meant for slaughtering. Now this will again destroy or rather disturb the balance of our ecology and environment, because the resources are always limited. We have to make best use of that. Either we grow crops or we rear animals for slaughtering. And look at the way the slaughterhouses work, how they are maintained. It's simply a hygienic horror. The conditions are appalling and totally unsanitary all over the world. Yesterday only on internet I got a report from foreign countries, advanced countries of America and France, that the conditions of slaughterhouses there also, it is reported, are totally unsanitary. I got a copy of white papers from a government accountability project of America, fighting filth on the kill floor, a matter of life and death for America's families. Slaughtering of animals, meat processing plants, and finally most unhygienic ways of transport and sale of flesh food has made flesh food totally unfit for human consumption. And do not think for a moment that imported, packaged, nicely packaged meat or canned meat is totally hygienic. No, my dear friends, that is also coming from those slaughterhouses where all these things which I have stated of medical science will apply. Not only that, they add certain preservatives, certain chemicals, certain additives which will keep the meat fresh. Environmental consciousness in India and abroad has now driven many people to vegetarianism. Environment friendly veg foods are now available. The craze now in all over the world is to go for environmental friendly veg food, because it is considered friendly and healthy. The green factories or glass houses are now exporting plant food, including fruits, to those countries which cannot grow them because of climate. The modern transportation system has given a much better alternative for food choice. In fact, for developing nations like India, government and NGOs should give more emphasis on larger production of more exports of plant food, which will solve the economic development of our country. Now look at the pollution. The pollution caused by legal and illegal slaughterhouses is terrific. The discharge of effluents from even so-called modern abattoirs is in the open and exposed to elements and public gaze. The carcasses of animals, the flow of blood, the horrible stench, etc. will add to the pollution. Ecological balance. Utility of animal world for human welfare cannot be overemphasized. Both are interdependent. Cows, sheep, fish, frogs, etc. are much more useful to us alive than dead. Then why should we kill our friends and our helpers to satisfy our taste buds? We should not be so much ungrateful, my friends, to our lesser beings, we call them animals or birds. Look at it from another point of view of natural manure. I've already stated that the animals produce much more natural and healthy manure than the artificial manure. artificial chemicals manures cost us dearly. Now again, I'm coming back to our economic term. It's we are importing artificial chemicals for manure purposes. That is again a drain on our exchequer. Friends, I will now briefly give you historical and geographical views. I have already touched upon it. Historically, in certain dry areas of miles and miles of desert where no vegetable can ever grow, maybe only food or survival was the animal food. Geographically, I stated as like Eskimos, there was no alternative. But once we have got this better alternative, which is healthier, which is more economical, which is more eco-friendly, why not go for such food? And friends, I will now go to the most important point, which will prove my point beyond any doubt that why man is vegetarian by nature. I've got some 16 points here to compare how our body is built up. As Mr. Trivedi has started the ball rolling in this fashion of bovine teeth and non-bovine teeth embedded. Now I will first say about herbivorous. Teeth of herbivorous animals are embedded in the jaws, short, blunt, close to one another. While in carnivorous, they are sharp, pointed, long and conical. The two or four teeth that we have got, like some people say they are like dog animals, they are not for meat eating, but they are found also in apes and chimpanzees, and which are fit for plucking the fruits and eating the fruits. The claws, no sharp nails for herbivorous, they are fit to pluck fruits only, while in carnivorous, their sharp nails helps in tearing apart the prey easily. Jaws and chewing habits. Jaws of a herbivorous will move up and down, left and right, that is in all directions. They swallow their food after chewing. While the carnivorous, the lower jaw moves upwards and downwards only. They swallow their food without mastication. Now friends, you go on comparing this. I will only say herbivorous and carnivorous. It is for you enlightened friends to see how our human body and parts of our human body will fit, whether it will fit with herbivorous animals or with carnivorous animals. Tongue. The tongue of herbivorous is quite smooth, while that of carnivorous is very rough. Water drinking habit. That's a very important thing. My friend Dr. Paresh Dalal told me. He said that these herbivorous animals, they drink water with lips by suction, while all the carnivorous, they drink the water with tongue, they lap up. We don't do it. We always use our lips. Now come to the length of intestine. Longer intestines are found in herbivorous, about four times the body length. This cannot quickly expel the flesh food, while in carnivorous, smaller size of intestine, almost equal to the body length, and helps to expel flesh food before it gets contaminated. Liver and kidney. Smaller in proportion in herbivorous, so they are unable to throw out waste material easily. While in carnivorous, liver and kidney are longer in proportion, so they can throw out waste material easily. Digestive system. There is a less hydrochloric acid in digestive system of herbivorous, thus flesh cannot be digested easily, while obviously in carnivorous the quantum of hydrochloric acid is much more, and that is why they can digest the flesh food, but human being cannot. Salvia. In herbivorous, like human being, the salvia is alkaline and contains phytalin, which helps in digesting carbohydrates found in the grains. While in carnivorous, the salvia is always acidic. The blood pH is alkaline, like human being in herbivorous, and acidic in carnivorous. The blood lipoproteins. Human blood lipoproteins is similar to all herbivorous, while it is not similar to that of carnivorous. Sense is weak. All the senses, particularly the eyesight, is weak in herbivorous and very powerful in carnivorous. Sound, the voice is not, the herbivorous sound or even the human sound is not frightening, unless of course we can make it now frightening. But by nature, the sound of all herbivorous is mild, while that of carnivorous like lions and tigers is very coarse and frightening. And lastly, infants. Normal sight power of right from now, see the young ones of herbivorous, right from the moment of birth, they can see very clearly. While all the infants of carnivorous wild animals are blind at least for a week. Now friends, it is for you to justify whether man fits by nature in this category of herbivorous grain eaters or in the category of carnivorous the flesh eaters. Now friends, I will now tell you about certain great persons who condemned flesh food. Looking at the world's history, we find that all great scholars, philosophers, scientists like Einstein, artists like Leonardo da Vinci, poets like Milton, Pope, Shelley, and writers like George Bernard Shaw, and religious leaders, of course, of the world. Now, who are those people? The mathematician, the Pythagoras, the Plutarch, Newton and Einstein, the scientist, Dr. Annie Besant, Reverend Dr. Walter Walsh, George Bernard Shaw, Tolstoy, the Greek philosopher Socrates and Aristotle. They are all enlightened people, and they say, yes, sir. They say that blessed are those with noble qualities of tolerance and compassion, love and non-violence, who are not flesh eaters. Now, friends, I will quote from George Bernard Shaw, which is very famous and widely published. We are living graves of murdered beasts. Listen what he says. We are living graves, moving graves of murdered beasts, slaughtered to satisfy our appetites. Like carrion crows, we live and feed on meat, regardless of the sufferings and the pain. Doctors once advised Bernard Shaw. He was very ill. He said that you must take some meat soup. Bernard Shaw said, I'll prefer death than to have anything with flesh food. And believe me, friends, he survived, and the doctor turned vegetarian. In the similar way, Mahatma Gandhi, his son was very sick. He was advised meat soup, and he refused, and the son survived. Why I am telling you, friends, all these things? That Mr. Trivedi said, yes, medically, whatever the doctor says, we have to accept, no doubt. But as I said in the very first thing, in the beginning I said, everything is relative. When doctor says something, he will say only from medical point of view. And friends, we are not living here. We are here on this earth, not only to survive. Survival is important, but not at the cost of others and inflict pain on others. Thank you very much, friends. 21st century will belong to vegetarians. Okay, I think I have made my points on very general terms, friends. I will tell you that I know those who are regularly flesh eaters are coming from some culture, some family, some faith, and that is why they have never applied their mind. And that is what Mr. Trivedi stated, that we are here today. We have gathered here. Let us apply our mind, that not only from religious angle or from our social angle, because I have seen, I'm not afraid to say, that many of our Jain friends, when they go to certain gatherings, because they are afraid of the social status, they start eating meat. I don't like that. But then it is for everybody, whether he is a vegetarian or a non-vegetarian. Apply your mind. Try to see from all these angles whether it is permitted or prohibited from our own health point of view, from the national point of view, from the social point of view, from ecological, from environmental, and above all, from compassion point of view. Friends, when nature has created all animals, all humans, all creatures equal, nobody has got right to kill anybody just to satisfy his own palates. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Zakir Naik to present his talk.
Alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalam, Allah Rasulullah wa ala ali wa sahbi ajma'in amma ba'd A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim Bismillahir rahmanir rahim Ya ayyuhallazina amanu awfu bil uqud uhillat lakum bahimatul anam illa ma yutla alaykum Bismillahir rahmanir rahim Rabbi shrah li sadri wa yassir li amri wa hlul 'uqdatam min lisani yafqahu qawli Respected Mr. Rashmi Azhaveri, Mr. Trivedi, Dr. Muhammad Naik, the respected people on the dais, my respected elders, and my dear brothers and sisters. I welcome all of you with the Islamic greetings. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May peace, mercy, and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Almighty God, be on all of you. The topic of this morning's debate is non-vegetarian food permitted or prohibited for a human being? It is not whether vegetarian food or non-vegetarian food which is healthy or which is better. If I prove that an apple is better than a mango, that doesn't mean mango is prohibited. This statement is sufficient to end the dialogue for me, but I have to reply. Non-vegetarian, by definition, means a person who has food of animal origin. It does not mean a person who does not have vegetarian food. It does not mean a person who does not have vegetables and fruits. Let it be very clear to all of you. A more technical and a scientific word is an omnivorous diet. A person who has many types of food, especially foods of plant and animal origin. Vegetarian, as Mr. Rashmi has very rightly said, it doesn't come from the word vegetables. It comes from vegetas, which means full of breath, full of life. He didn't give a better explanation. We can talk about it. And he didn't speak. There are various types of vegetarian. We have fructarian, who only eat fruits and nuts. Then we have the vegans, who don't have any animal products. We have lacto-vegetarian, what I believe Mr. Rashmi Azhaveri is. They have milk. We have the ovo-vegetarians, who have eggs. We have the lacto-ovo-vegetarian, who have egg and milk also. We have the pesco-vegetarian, who eat fish. We have semi-vegetarian, who also have chicken. This classification is done by the Vegetarian Society, not by me. And you can name another 20. Time doesn't permit me. I would like to state a quotation by Dr. William T. Jarvis. Dr. William T. Jarvis, he is the advisor to the American Council of Science and Health, ACSH. And he's also the professor of public health and preventive medicine in the Loma Linda University. And he's also the founder and the president of the National Council Against Health Frauds. And he's the co-editor of the book, The Health Robbers, A Closer Look at Quackery in America. Most of the quotations are from America. And according to him, he classifies vegetarian based on the behavioral standpoint into two categories: pragmatic vegetarian and ideological vegetarian. A pragmatic vegetarian chooses his diets on objective health reasons. He is more reasonable in his approach rather than emotional. The ideological vegetarian, on the other hand, he chooses his diet based on a principle, which is based on an ideology. He is more emotional rather than reasonable. And Dr. William B. Jarvis says, one can spot an ideological vegetarian by his exaggerations of the benefits of vegetarianism. And you could see that in the talk which preceded my talk. Exaggeration of benefits of vegetarianism and the lack of skepticism and the overlooking of the fact that extreme vegetarianism can lead to potential health risks. He says that the ideological vegetarian, he pretends to be like a scientist, but he's more like a lawyer than like a scientist. And you could see that in the talk by the learned speaker. more like a lawyer than like a scientist. They gather data and information selectively against the information which is against the ideology. This may be good for a debate like the one we are having, but not for engendering scientific understanding. Dr. William T. Jarvis says that ideological vegetarianism is filled with hypotheses. It is filled with extremism from which even scientists and doctors are not immune. And that you can see the quotation. Mr. Rashmi Azhavari has said several diseases. And it's possible for me to refute each and every, but if time permits. He's talking about science, but the approach was not scientific. All can be prevented very well. Prevention is better than cure, is the base of the medicine, which time will not permit me to go into health issues, etc. in the rebuttal if time permits. I'll try and cover most of the other aspects. And health, I will try and cover in the rebuttal. Let's analyze the various reasons why a person chooses a food habit. It can be religious, it can be geographical location, it can be a personal choice, smell, taste, color, due to humane or ethical consideration, due to anatomical and physiological consideration, due to behavioral consideration. It can be due to ecological and economical consideration. It can be due to nutritional value or due to health and scientific reasons. Health and medical reasons. Let's first analyze the religious reasons. Mr. Trivedi said that religion should not interfere with the human being where it's concerned what we should eat and what we should not eat. That you should leave it up to the doctors. I agree with him that most of the religions, that is the case. The religious authorities, the main foundation that's Almighty God, if he's not a doctor, the God that you worship is not a doctor, then you should not follow him. He says leave it to the doctors. But in Islam, we believe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Almighty God, is our creator. And the creator of the human beings has far superior knowledge than all the doctors put together in all the years. And you can find the statements, as Mr. Rashmi Azhavari said, all from doctors. He's quoting from these books, which I think is available for sale outside, all these books. I will touch on some of these points. All, out of which many are fictitious. Fictitious don't exist at all. Some are irrelevant. Some are untested, and some are truths, which are half-baked truths. I would like to make one point crystal clear. That while I prove undoubtedly that non-veg food should be permitted for the human beings, I do not have the slightest intention to hurt the feelings of any vegetarians. And while I prove logically and scientifically that non-veg food is permitted, and if someone feels hurt, his sentiments are hurt, I apologize in advance. I sincerely apologize. My intention is not to hurt anybody's feeling, but I have to reply to the presentation of the earlier speaker. As far as Islam is concerned, it is not compulsory for a human being to have non-veg. A Muslim can be a very good Muslim even by being a pure vegetarian. But, when our Creator, Almighty God Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, gives us permission to have non-veg, why should we not have it? And I start my talk by giving a quotation from the glorious Quran, from Surah Maidah, chapter number 5, verse number 1, which says, Ya ayyuha allazina amanu, O you believe, awfu bil uqood, uhillat lakum bahimatul anam, illa ma yutla alaykum. Fulfill all your obligations. And lawful for you for food are all four-footed animals with the exceptions named. Quran further says in Surah An-Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 5, that cattle has been created by God for you. In it are various benefits. You derive warmth, and of the meat you can eat. The same message is repeated in Surah Mu'minun, chapter 23, verse 21, that you can have the meat of the cattle. Let's analyze the geographical reasons and the surrounding environment. And as we know, it influences a person's food habit. Like people living in the coastal region, the Konkanis, they have more fish. People living in South India, they have more rice. People living in the deserts, where the scarcity of vegetation, people mainly survive on the flesh of animals. The Eskimo, the Arctic region, where there's scarcity of edible vegetation, they survive more on seafood. And Mr. Zaveri said that he knows that vegetable is not available in certain parts of the world, but today, due to advancement of transportation, we can supply them with vegetables. I would request the Indian Vegetarian Congress to supply, at least give the transportation cost, that's all, to supply to the Eskimos, to supply to Saudi Arabia. You get vegetables in Saudi Arabia, it is more expensive. Why? Because the cost of transportation. That makes it more expensive. It is illogical and unscientific to spend more money to buy a food which is less nutritious. Let's analyze the humane reasons, the ethical reasons, and the pure vegetarians, they say that all life is sacred and no living creature should be killed. They fail to realize that today it's a universal fact that even plants have got life. So the main argument on killing living creature doesn't hold good today. Previously, maybe, a couple of centuries ago, it may have held some weight, but today it carries no weight. Then they further argue today and they say, yes, we know that plants have got life, but they can't feel pain. Therefore, killing a plant is a lesser crime and lesser sin as compared to killing an animal. Today, science has further advanced and we have come to know that even the plants can feel pain. They can even cry. But the cry of the plant cannot be heard by the human ear because the audible frequency range of the human ear is from 20 cycles per second to 20,000 cycles per second. Anything below and above this, the human ear can't hear. But the cry of the animal can be heard by the human beings, but the cry of the plant cannot be heard by the human beings. Just because you cannot hear the cry of the plant, that doesn't justify you to inflict pain or kill the plant. There was an ideological vegetarian who had a discussion with me. He told me that, Mr. Zakir, I know that plants have life. They feel pain. But you know, plants, they have got about 2 senses less as compared to the animals. I said, for sake of argument, I agree with you. But then I asked him a simple question. Let's suppose your brother is born deaf and dumb. Cannot hear, cannot speak. 2 senses less. And when he grows up, and when someone comes and murders him, will you go and tell the judge, oh me Lord, give the murderer less punishment because my brother had 2 senses less? In fact, you will say, usne to masoom ko mara hai. He has killed an innocent person. Give him a bigger punishment. And further, if you analyze that in Islam, as far as living creatures are concerned, there are two types, broadly classified two types. Human beings who are living creatures and non-human being living creatures. As far as killing the human beings are concerned, Quran says in Surah Maida, chapter number 5, verse number 32, that if any person, if anyone, kills any human being, unless it be for murder or for spreading mischief in the land, it is as though he has killed the whole of humanity. And if anyone saves any human being, it is as though he has saved the whole nation. If any person kills any human being, Muslim or non-Muslim, unless it be for murder or for creating mischief, Quran says he has killed the whole of humanity. If you save any human being, you have saved the whole of humanity. As far as non-human being living creatures are concerned, no human being should harm them unnecessarily, should not kill them unnecessarily for sports or for fun or for target practice. But if it is for your security and for your safety, you can stop them, you can even kill them. Or if you want for lawful food, but not just for fun and frolic or for hunting. Even if I agree that the plants are a lesser species as compared to the human beings, if you take the life of one animal, an average animal, it can feed about 100 human beings. For the same 100 human beings, you may have to kill more than 100 plants. So is it preferable to take the life of one living animal or the life of 100 living plants? Which is a bigger sin? Is it a bigger sin to kill 100 human beings who are handicapped or kill one healthy human being? Which is a bigger sin? You decide for yourself. There is a vegetarian society by the name of World Foundation on Reverence for All Life. Most of the quotation which he gave is from here and from these three books, most of them, almost all. The name of the foundation is World Foundation on Reverence for All Life. They forgot to mention except plant life in bracket. And it says, all creation is one family. All life is sacred. What kind of an ideology is this that you permit the killing of one family member but do not permit the killing of the other family member? It's illogical and unscientific. You know, in America, there are vegetarian society who take students to slaughterhouses and they make them see the bloodshed and convert them to vegetarianism. It is like a doctor taking the young girls to observe and watch a difficult childbirth and then say, that's the reason you should not marry and should not have children. These are unethical forms of mind control. Unethical. Unethical. In fact, we should teach our children that when vegetables can be grown for food, why can't animals be raised for food? All life is sacred. I agree. Unnecessary killing them is wrong. But for a requirement, lawful food is permitted. Let's analyze the anatomical and the behavioral consideration. And there were a list of various things mentioned by Mr. Zaveri. You know, he was reading from paper at 100 miles per hour, asking to note down, note down, note down. How many diseases? I, being a medical doctor, can answer, but how much can answer? To name 10 diseases will take few seconds. To reply all 10 will take more than an hour. And he listed a lot. I'll just try and tell you that if you go to authentic books, not researches made by ideological vegetarians, most of the answers are given on the medical aspect. Considering the anatomical and the physiological aspect, and rightly said that if you observe the teeth of the herbivorous animal, the cow, the goat, the sheep, they have a flat set of teeth. They only have vegetables. If you observe the teeth of the carnivorous animal, lion, tiger, leopard, they have pointed set of teeth. They only have animal flesh, not non-veg. Animal flesh. They are not called as non-veg animals. They are called as carnivorous animals. There's a difference between carnivorous and non-veg. Non-veg actually is omnivorous. But if you analyze the set of teeth of the human beings, we have got flat teeth as well as pointed teeth. If Almighty God, our Creator, wanted us to have only vegetables, why did He give us these pointed teeth? For what? And Mr. Zaveri said, these pointed teeth, they are not referring to the dog. They refer to the apes. He doesn't know the scientific meaning of the word canine. Comes from the root word caninus in Latin, which means of dog. And canine means pertaining to the family of Canida, like wolves, dogs, etc. Scientists have given this name. Canine, meaning pertinent to dog. And he said, it doesn't look like the teeth of dogs. It refers to teeth of apes and monkeys. I believe in agreeing with the argument and proving my point, then you disprove him. It's easy. Even if I agree, it is the teeth like the monkeys. Do you know monkeys also have non-veg? They have the lice. There are many species of ape who even have raw flesh of animals. Many species of apes who have raw flesh. They're omnivorous. Who says they're carnivorous? They're omnivorous. They aren't pure veg also. And many species are even called as cannibals. Some species of apes and monkeys. If you analyze the digestive system of the human being, it can digest both veg as well as non-veg. If Almighty God wanted us to have only vegetables, why did he give us a digestive system which can digest both veg as well as non-veg? And Mr. Zaveri said that we cannot have raw flesh. I agree with him, most human beings cannot have raw flesh. In the same way, most of the human beings cannot have raw vegetables, raw vegetarian diet, like raw wheat, raw rice. Can you have it? Raw moong, raw drumstick. Can you have? You'll get indigestion. So what is the argument? No, no, you have to cook them. I know as a medical doctor that raw wheat, raw rice, raw drumstick, if you have, you'll have problems. You can't digest them. So you have to cook them. Similarly with the flesh, we non-vegetarians, we cook them for easy digestion. But yet, there are certain human beings who even have raw meat. He gave the name of Eskimos. He didn't tell the root word meaning. The root word meaning of Eskimo, it literally means eaters of raw flesh. So there are human beings who even have raw meat. They're conditioned. Tomorrow, if you're conditioned to eat raw wheat and raw rice, even you may be able to digest it. But most human beings cannot digest certain raw vegetables. That doesn't mean you should not have rice, you should not have wheat, that you should not have drumsticks. There are, in the herbivorous animals, an enzyme known as cellulase enzyme. And every vegetable has cellulase. And this cellulase enzyme helps in digesting the vegetables. We human beings, we don't have cellulase enzymes. Therefore, the vegetables we eat, the cellulose part remains undigested, and we call them as fibers. It's undigested. On the other hand, there are certain enzymes like lipase, trypsin, chemotrypsin, which are mainly meant for digesting non-vegetarian food. If Almighty God did not want us to have non-veg food, why did he give us these enzymes? And the primitive man, as said by the earlier speaker as well as the chief guest, archaeological evidence shows us clearly the Homo sapiens, the Eskimos, the Australian aborigines, they were non-veg. So why the change now? We have the same teeth, we have the same digestive system, and he has given a list of other comparison which prove we can have veg. And I agree with that. Where did I ever say that you cannot have veg? A non-veg is a person who has the food of the animal products as well as vegetarian food. It's an omnivorous diet. He said that the liver and the kidney in carnivorous animal is large. In the human beings, it is small like the herbivorous because the animals have raw meat. Therefore, they have to remove the toxin on a higher level. We do it by cooking the food. Therefore, God gave us a small kidney and a small liver, which is sufficient to digest both cooked non-veg and also vegetables. Similarly, with all the arguments, HCl, it's not very acidic. Why? Because we don't require it. If you don't require it, why should God unnecessarily give it to us? Same with saliva, same with the pH of the blood, same with the lipoprotein. All the arguments are that because they have raw flesh, therefore they require it. We don't require it. So why should God give us? Yes. It's required for digesting veg food and cooked non-veg food. He said, carnivorous animals, they lick. And the herbivorous animals, they sip. We human beings, we do both. We do both. When we drink, while we drink, we sip. When we have ice cream, what do? We lick. We lick also and we sip also, depending upon what is the food we are eating. Even the tea we can lick, not that we can't lick. But why do we waste time? It will take more time. Similar with all the arguments he's given about the teeth being closed. Because we also have vegetables. If God would have asked us not to have vegetables, then maybe the teeth were far apart. He asked us to have both non-veg as well as veg food. And there are various verses in the Quran talking about various foods, pomegranates, talking about vegetables, talking about dates, etc., which we should have. The plants, many vegetarians say, that they regrow. Therefore, we aren't killing the plant, and there are some plants which have that facility, not all plants. There are various, which we cut, it regrows. So this is the only argument, that because it regrows, you can have veg food. You know, if you cut the tail of the lizard, it regrows. Will you have the tail of the lizard? It's a delicacy. There are human beings, the Australian Aborigines, they relish the lizard. Will you have the tail of the lizard? And the answer will be no. You know what I'm doing now? I'm behaving like a lawyer. I'm feeling ashamed to answer all these things, but I have to do, because it is also a debate. I had come here so that we understand better and have a friendly understanding of each other, but I have to behave like a lawyer also, besides being logical and scientific, because the arguments put forth, anyone who has general knowledge can reply. But because people don't have general knowledge, many people aren't aware. That's why these arguments may satisfy many people. And all these arguments are given in the books, which are distributed. Meat Eating, 100 Facts by Naomi Chan, distributed by Jain Organization, also by the Indian Vegetarian Congress. This is a book given to me by Mr. Zaveri. 100 Facts About Egg, Vegetarian or Non-Vegetarian. Each and every argument can be disproved. Certain things I know, that non-veg causes diseases which can be prevented. Let's analyze the behavioral consideration. He gave certain arguments. The food we eat has an effect on our behavior. I agree with him to a certain level. The food we eat has an effect on our behavior. That's the reason we Muslims have the flesh of herbivorous animal like goat, sheep, who are docile and peace-loving. We want to be peace-loving and docile. We don't have the meat of the carnivorous animal like lion, tiger, dog, pig, etc. And the Prophet clearly says, all these animals are prohibited. We are peace-loving people. Therefore, we want to have animals which are peaceful. And countering argument, you all eat plants and you all behave like plants. That is suppression of the senses. A lower species. I know scientifically it is wrong. I'm only behaving like a lawyer. I feel ashamed to speak these points as a medical doctor. It's not true that you eat plants, you behave like plants. But the argument he has put forth, I'm giving a counter reply. You eat plants and you behave like plants, weak and suppressed, can't move properly. I'm sorry. I really apologize. I have to reply to the arguments. I apologize if I've hurt the feeling of any vegetarian. It is not scientifically true. It's just an argument, a counter-argument. Further, he gave the list of various peace-loving people like Mahatma Gandhi, and I respect Mahatma Gandhi because he has done certain good things for India and humanity. But if, because Mahatma Gandhi was peaceful, indicates that if you have veg food makes you peaceful, then today if you analyze the list of the Nobel Prize winners for peace, almost all or most of them are non-vegetarian. Menachem Begin, non-veg. Yasser Arafat, non-veg. Anwar Sadat, non-veg. Mother Teresa, non-veg. Mother Teresa. I want to ask you a simple question. Which man in the history of humankind is known maximum for killing maximum human beings? Can you guess? Hitler! Adolf Hitler! He has killed 6 million Jews. Was he a non-veg or veg? Vegetarian! Anyhow, there are crusaders of vegetarians. You know, now on the internet if you go, they say, see, Adolf Hitler was a vegetarian is a myth. He sometimes had non-veg. And the other side says that, you know, when he had gastric problems, that time he had vegetable foods only. To tell you frankly, on a scientific viewpoint, I do not consider the diet of Hitler to be responsible for him killing 6 million Jews. Neither am I telling, irrespective whether you are a vegetarian or non-vegetarian, I'm not interested in knowing, because I, being a doctor, I know it doesn't carry any weight. There were other factors which influenced him to take this drastic step, which is totally inhumane, not the diet. There are various researches done. There have been researches in America on a group of students who are pure non-veg and on a group of students who are veg, pure veg. And they analyze that the group of students who were non-veg, they were less violent and they were more social. But it's a research. It's not a scientific fact. I will never use this as an argument to prove that non-veg food makes you peaceful. No. I'm a doctor, more of a doctor, as well as lawyer where required, because I'm in a debate. There are researches, but these researches aren't scientific facts. Most of the statements what Mr. Rashmi Zaveri made, all were researches, not scientific facts. There is not a single authentic medical book which says that non-veg food in general should be prohibited. Not a single. All the researches, like the research done by this person in America, then they say that veg food makes a person intelligent. And he gave a list of great names, Albert Einstein and Isaac Newton, etc., etc. If we analyze the list of the Nobel Prize winners in all these years, majority were non-veg. Majority. And today, animal behavioral scientists, they say that the carnivorous animal should be more intelligent than the herbivorous animal in order to catch the prey. If he's not intelligent, how will he catch the prey? But anyway, I'm not going to use this as an argument, therefore non-veg food makes you intelligent, because these things don't actually affect a human being. The diet does affect a human being, but the arguments don't affect. The arguments don't affect. And all the other arguments given, they don't carry weight actually. There are people who give examples that non-veg food makes you strong is a myth. It's a scientific fact mentioned in several medical books, authentic, that non-veg food is good for health. It does have disease also, you can prevent them. There are proteins which I'll come to it later on. And to counter-argue that, they give an example of Yadunath Singh Naik. Has anyone heard of him? Yadunath Singh Naik. In the army, it is mentioned in this book, vegetarian or non-vegetarian, choose yourself, by Gopinath Agarwal. Yadunath Naik, being a vegetarian in the army, in wrestling he defeated 2 non-vegetarians. Therefore, veg food makes you strong. I feel ashamed to reply to these arguments. I feel ashamed. It's a known fact that the title holders of world wrestling, yes, there are vegetarian wrestlers also, but if you compare with the full world, almost all the title holders of world wrestling are non-veg. The person known in bodybuilding maximum, who is he? Arnold Schwarzenegger. 13 times world titles he got. 7 as Mr. Olympia, 5 as Mr. Universe, and 1 as Mr. World. What was he, veg or non-veg? Non-veg. The boxer Muhammad Ali, Cassius Clay, non-veg. Mike Tyson, non-veg. Yes, of course, non-veg food does add to the strength. That is a scientific fact. That's the reason that if you analyze, that when a person is convalescing from a disease, it's preferable non-veg food. Not that you have to have non-veg, it's preferable egg, etc. And I'll come to it later on. And then they give an example of a wrestler, Professor Ram Murthy. Never heard his name. He says it's a world famous wrestler. Who has heard of him? Anyone has heard of him? Professor Ram Murthy? No one. World famous. Where do you get this news from? World famous. Then they give the example of Paramjit Singh in London, pure vegetarian, who skips 2,000 times a day. Therefore, vegetarian food makes you an athlete. If these are the arguments supposed to be scientific, I really feel ashamed. Most of the athletic record holders, here's the Guinness book. You can go through it. I've brought it along here. All mentioned, about bodybuilding, athletic, 100 meters dash, all these people. If at random also we check up their dietary history, even giving benefit of doubt, more than 80 to 90% will be non-veg. But I will be a fanatic if I say that all these records are only due to the diets. I'll be a fanatic. A few records may be related to the diet, but not all. For the argument they give that the smell and the sight of a carnivorous animal is strong. The night vision is strong. As Mr. Rashmi Ajavari said, night vision and sense of smell is strong in carnivorous. In herbivorous, it is less. In human meat, it is less. Therefore, we should be vegetarian. There are herbivorous animals, like the bee, whose sense of smell is very strong. And they even have a very good night vision. See, these are arguments which are not scientific, may be useful in a debate to convince the people illogically. Therefore, I'm here. Then he gave the example. You know, animals have hoarse voice, you know, coarse voice, the carnivorous animal. Herbivorous animals don't have coarse voice. And to ask a simple question, which animal is maximum known for a hoarse voice? Donkey. Veg or non-veg? Veg or non-veg? Veg. Anyway, by no means am I trying to prove that vegetarian food creates hoarse voice or non-vegetarian food creates melodious voice. If you see the list of singers, many are non-veg, many are veg also. So just by quoting singers who are veg saying, oh, that's why vegetarian diet makes you melodious, is all illogical arguments. Really, I feel ashamed to answer all these things. And he gave certain economic points, that economic reasons why we should have vegetarian food. It's more economical, according to Mr. Zaveri. And he gave several statistics, so many calories, so many this, so many tons of protein, which is mentioned here. From where they get the statistics, God alone knows. And he mentioned some protein. It's also mentioned in his book that 1 kg of animal protein that we get, you have to feed so many plants, etc. Therefore, it is equivalent to 7 kgs of veg protein. So if you're having meat for 1 kg protein, you are taking 7 kg vegetables. Therefore, vegetable is cheaper. How they get this kg of protein, I being a medical doctor, don't realize. Is it kg of food or kg of protein? And if I agree with them, I agree with them. Okay, you say, for sake of argument, 2 plus 2 is 5. I agree, and then ask you, let's say, take 2 rupees, give me 5 rupees. Take 2,000, give me 5,000. Similarly, if I agree it is right, all the statistics, then I tell that the vegetarians, they should thank the non-vegetarians. You know why? Because if we would not have slaughtered the animal for food, it would have lived for another 5 to 10 years. And in that time, you would have had the vegetables of 7 to 8 people for a few years. So you should thank us from preventing the animal from eating your vegetable food. Furthermore, he gave the calculation from some record, from where, I don't know. 1:14, the land that you graze required for animal is 14 times more than the land required for food, etc. Same example is given here, that the land required to produce 1 ton of beef, the same land you can feed 5 average families. 1 ton of beef is equivalent to 10 or 20 tons of veg food. And the land required to graze an animal can raise 5 average families. My early argument also holds good here. But besides that, these ideological vegetarians, they fail to realize that the animals graze on land which is unsuitable for growing crops. They eat the plants which is inedible for the human beings, like husk and stalks, corn stalks. They don't eat plants which are edible for the human beings. Yes, they can eat. But when they enter the fields, the farmer, Bud Natural, takes them out of the field. Why? To cause loss. Yes, if you have excess of crop, etc., there are certain governments who even feed them. And there are nomadic populations who make their living by grazing animals on land which is unsuitable for crop growing. But they eat the vegetation which is inedible to the human beings and they make their living. Even the animal lives, even the human being lives. And today, according to UN report, about 23% approximately of the land in the world is used for pastures, 23% for forest, less than 10% for cultivation. The remaining 45%, majority, can yet be used for growing crops. Why don't you use that? Why are you running after the food of the animals, poor living creatures? Let them live, let them eat. Why are you stopping them from eating? If the non-vegetarians stop slaughtering the cattle, do you know that there will be overpopulation of cattle? Overpopulation. I am aware that human beings, they raise animals for food. That means by methods, they increase the multiplication of the animals. But if suppose I agree that from today, all non-vegetarians stop raising animals for food and stop killing them for food. Yet they will grow in population. You know why? Human beings. In all these years, our population is increasing. Even with all the family planning method, with all the birth control, hamdo hamare do, yet we are increasing. There is no birth control method among the cattle, and the gestation is less than the human beings. 5 months to 6 months to 8 months. Less than the human beings. And they multiply faster. So if we stop killing and stop raising, yet within a few decades, you'll have problems not of overpopulation of human beings, of overpopulation of cattle. How are we going to solve it? There are various nutrition. You talked about protein, etc. If time permits, I will speak in the rebuttal. I would like to make a statement of Dr. George R. Kerr, which is sufficient to counter all his arguments on health. Dr. George R. Kerr, he is a professor of nutrition in the University of Texas. Why I'm giving the designation, you can come to know that these people actually specialize in catching health fraud. People who deal in fraud in health. He says that virtually all authors of the diet and disease books, they propose hypotheses which are untested, ill-tested, unfound, unlikely, or disproved. I would like to repeat. Dr. George R. Kerr says, virtually all authors of books on diet and disease, they propose hypothesis which is ill-tested, unfound, non-tested, unlikely, or disproved. Time is running short. I would like to make the statement that's given by the American Council on Science and Health. Just a statement. See, they are experts. These quotation of research and scientific facts, all this quotation that this causes this disease, that some are scientific facts, but they can be prevented. But the other thing was mentioning about this land and that land, these are only statistics done by individual researchers. Even when you do PhD, you can do a research and that will come into account, but won't carry weight. American Council on Science and Health says that a person need not abstain from meat and be a vegetarian to have a healthy diet. And the topic is not veg or non-veg, which is healthier. It is non-veg food permitted or prohibited for the human beings? And I will list out the points in summary to make it easier for Mr. Zaveri to answer in the rebuttal. Point number one, there is not a single major religion which bans or prohibits all non-veg food in general. Point number two, geographical places like Arctic, Eskimos live. How could you have provided food all these years back? And today also, if you provide, it's going to be more expensive. Point number three, if all life is sacred, why do you kill the plants? Even they have life. Point number four, even plants feel pain. Point number five, even if I agree they have two senses less, killing a creature of two senses less is a lesser crime, is illogical. Point number six, it's preferable to kill one animal and take one animal life than to take 100 lives of plants for feeding 100 people. Point number seven, each and every argument can be disproved. The liver, and the kidney, HCl. Same with saliva, same with the pH of the blood, same with the lipoprotein. Point number 8. Human beings have an omnivorous set of teeth for eating veg as well as non-veg. Point number 9. They have a digestive system which can digest both veg and non-veg, and have proved it, scientifically have proved by the enzymes. Point number 10. Primitive man was non-veg. So you can't say it's prohibited for human beings, even for that person. Point number 11. The food you eat has an effect on the behavior, but saying that non-veg food makes you violent has got no scientific base at all. Point number 12, giving argument that veg food makes you strong, makes you peaceful, makes you intelligent, makes you athletes, are all myths. Point number 13, night vision and sense of smell is strong in carnivorous. In herbivorous, it is less. The carnivorous animal have hoarse voice, you know, coarse voice. Herbivorous animal don't have coarse voice. Are all illogical arguments. Point number 14, that veg food is cheaper, I've disproved it. It's not economical. In certain countries, yes, like India, it can be. But if you go abroad, in the Western countries, veg food is more expensive. And fresh veg food is phenomenal. Fresh vegetables. Furthermore, point number 15, that the land required to graze the animal will cause scarcity of the land for growing crops is also wrong. Point number 16. If the non-vegetarians stop slaughtering the cattle, do you know that there will be overpopulation of cattle? Point number 17. According to Dr. Kerr, these books written by dietitian, they can't be relied upon. All the statistics given are mainly from there. There is not a single statement, point number 18, in any authentic medical book which says non-veg food in general should be banned. Point number 19, there is not a single government on the face of the earth which has banned all non-veg food as a general rule. And point number 20, that even the American Council on Science and Health has said that for a healthy diet, being a pure vegetarian is not required. These are sufficient proof, logical and scientific, that non-veg food has to be permitted. If Mr. Zaveri doesn't agree, I request him to answer scientifically, not by comparison on just researches. But yet if Mr. Rashmibai Zaveri doesn't reply to more than 20 points which I've put forth, yet I will not ask him to become a non-veg, because I'm not a fanatic non-vegetarian. I'm not. Yet if you want to continue eating vegetarian food, I have got no objection. It's a personal choice. It's a personal choice. Some people like, due to certain taste, etc. It's a personal choice. And only thing I'd like to tell the people, that the vegetarians, the ideological vegetarians who do so much propaganda that this have got more value, etc., they should stop such things and stop distributing these type of books which mislead the people. I would like to end my talk by giving the quotation of the glorious Quran from Surah Nahl, chapter 16, verse 125, which says, "Udu ila sabili rabbika bil hikmah, wal ma'azatil hasna, wajadun billati ahsan." That is, invite all to the way of thy Lord with wisdom and beautiful preaching, and argue with them and reason with them in the ways that are best and most gracious. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillah rabbil alamin.
لِرَبِّكَ بِالْحِكْمَةِ وَالْمَوْعِظَةِ الْحَسَنَةِ وَجَادِلْهُم بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنُ.
Invite all to the way of thy Lord with wisdom and beautiful preaching, and argue with them in ways that are best and most gracious.
I now call upon Mr. Rashmi Bhai Jhaveri to present his response to Dr. Zakir Naik. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Rashmi Bhai Jhaveri.
First of all, I really thank Dr. Zakir Naik for giving me the choice whether I would like to still remain a vegetarian or non-vegetarian. Thank you very much. I would request Mr. Coordinator that would you like to have the rebuttal or my comments now, or shall we have?
No.
Because after all, you know, this is...
No. Now is better, you know, we'll...
Let's have some question answer, if you think.
Question answer we have in the third session. We have three-part session. Yes, Mr. Jhaveri, you can continue.
Now, we are totally at the command of the coordinator, so I will...
No, as decided, you know, the same format we keep.
I will obey.
I will not allow Dr. Zakir also to change the format.
Now,
I'll object.
First thing that I will say, it's not a question of whether one is logical or illogical, and it's not a question of the choice that one makes. As I said in my talk earlier, everything is relative, and you have to understand this topic from that perspective. Now, one thing that I will really strongly object with respect to Dr. Zakir's, that not a single religion prohibits non-veg. I am expert, I can say, because I am a student, I have done MA in genealogy, I can say from my religious point of view that Lord Mahavir and our all 24 Tithankaras very vehemently prohibited non-veg food. I have already given you some quotations. You see, mainly arguments of Dr. Dean Ornish is based on the fact that non-veg food contains excessive protein, cholesterol, and saturated fat. So that is why he said that for healthy and peaceful living, you must have non-veg veg diet. Now, he said that plant has also got life. No, it is not only proved by Dr. Jagdish Chandra Bose, but even our Lord Mahavir, he stated 2,500 years ago that not only plant, air, water, fire, minerals of the earth, they all have life. He has not said that you are allowed to kill this life and maintain yourself. But he was a practical Tirthankara. So he said that those who cannot renounce this world and become Jain Muni. You know, Jain Munis, they don't even kill plant vegetation or even other living beings for their food. They bake the food which is cooked in our house. We'll not go into that controversy that even you kill it and then give them. That's a separate story. But the teachings of Mahavir are very clear that you shall not harm any living being, whether animate or inanimate. Now, because of certain constraint for those people who cannot renounce the world, he has said that at least you can avoid essential killing. He has said that even if you, when you have food made out of plant, it is violence, it is hinsa, but it is necessary. So what I prohibit is unnecessary killing. Friends, this is a very sharp distinction, but very important distinction we should make, that if the alternative is available, we should not go for that alternative which compels us to kill and eat our own fellow creatures. Another thing, sir. He said plants. In my talk I stated about plant food, and he said that even a lizard can grow tail. That's the only exception. The plants, you pluck fruits, they will give you more fruits. You cut their branches, more branches will grow. See, there is no end to such argument. So let us restrict our argument to this. About medical science, and he rightly stated that medically also he has given certain things. I have also stated. Now it is for the enlightened audience to decide whether the scientific facts that I have given are correct or he has given. It's okay. It's a question of argument. Now he has conveniently forgotten. Please excuse me, I am telling because I am trying to rebut your things. The psychological aspect. When we consume animal food, we also inherit certain animal instincts. What have you to say? Please, in your rebuttal, you can say that. Now, doctors also, most of the doctors prescribe raw vegetable. Now, coming to cooking, most of the doctors prescribe raw vegetables for healthy diet. Only that food or cereals which will not be proper for a human being to consume raw, that only can be cooked. But as far as possible, and in our Indian Vegetarian Congress, we always, whenever we have a meeting, we have most of the food raw, uncooked, and that is more healthy, according to us. About the books, these books were not given by me to Dr. Nayak, and it was given by my friend, Mr. Salecha, who approached me. That's okay, it's nothing very important. Now, I will tell you one thing, that you cannot alter the truth by just loud applause. Okay. If you are impressed by my argument, you may applaud me. Or if you are impressed by the other argument, you can applaud that. But I firmly believe that just because some arguments are appealing to you and you applaud them loudly, will not alter the truth. And I have referred to about one book, Dr. Deepak Chopra. He has also written many books. He is also a physician, practicing physician, like Dr. Dean Ornish. He has also conducted researches. And he has come out with a theory that your food will have a terrific effect on your impulses and urges, your physical development, psychological development, and emotional development. You know, most of the psychological and emotional distortions are because of the flesh food that one eats, and that is why it is prohibited. It is totally illogical to say that by eating animals, you are helping vegetarians. We should not worry about the animal population because nature is quite capable of taking care. Why? Because we are rearing more animals for killing. That is why if we are not doing it, look at the jungle. Everywhere the natural cycle is there. Balancing will take care of itself. Nobody has to worry about it. Now, as per the history that Mr. Trivedi also referred, and also Dr. Jakir. Now I will tell from Jain historical point of view that in our Jain scriptures it is mentioned very clearly that those persons who were living in prehistoric stage, they lived under a tree and they were sufficiently provided by trees. They did not have to go for any killing. Friends, I am of course given more time, but I really personally feel that let's not have a sort of dialogue or arguments between. I would like very much the audience to participate and have more time for question and answer. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Zaveri. We have 5 minutes more. It's taking 5 minutes left. Now I call upon Dr. Zakir Naik to present a response to Mr. Rashmi Bhai Zaveri. For 15 minutes only.
Alhamdulillah. Wa salatu wa salam. Ala Rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Amma ba'd. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Wa qul jaal haq wa zaqal batil. Inna la batila kana zahuka. Nuzul min al-Quran ma huwa shifaa'un wa rahmatul mu'minin. Wa la yazidu zalimin illa khasara. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Rabbi shrah li sadri. Wa yassir li amri. Wa halul 'uqdatan min lisani. Yafkahu kawli. The respected people on the dais, and my respected elders, and my brothers and sisters, I welcome once again all of you with Islamic greetings. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May peace, mercy, and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be on all of you. I have not conveniently forgotten anything. If you realize I spoke maybe half minute more than the time allotted, so how can you say I conveniently forgot? If you give me even 5 hours more, if you're willing to stay. Because you are the person who kept time restrictions. You know, less time 30. I had to bargain for 15 minutes. I would love to speak for 2 hours. Even full day, I can do it. Because I'm a marathon speaker. Alhamdulillah. I'm a non-vegetarian. Mr. Zaveri said that I said that no religion prohibits non-veg. I never said no religion. I said no major religion. It's being recorded. No major religion. And Jainism is not a major religion. According to the books you gave me, you gave certain books, Jain is only 0.4% of India, 0.4. Less than 1%. Can you call it a major religion? In India, leave aside world out of the question. Negligible. I am very clear cut in my statement. Regarding the argument on Jainism, I can reply, but the coordinator won't give me permission. I am restricted to Islam. You know, I can reply even on Jainism. I am a student of comparative.
Excuse me, sir, you can't interfere when the speaker is speaking.
Brother is saying, I did not say, you can very well see the video cassette. There is not a single major religion which bans or prohibits all non-veg food in general. You can see the video cassette.
And ask your question in question time, please.
Don't get irritated. The diet will help you. Don't get irritated. Brother Rashmi Bhai already said, I did not answer whether you get animal instinct. I said in my lecture, I think you didn't hear. I said we eat peaceful animals like goat, sheep, because we want to be peaceful. And therefore when I came starting, I always said, peace be on all of you. Further, he said, I didn't state Dr. Dean Ornish. I yet challenge him. If his book is referred by any authentic medical college, authentic book, not just dietary books, that answer already gave by Dr. William T. Jarvis. Even scientists and medical professionals are not immune to the ideological thinking of the vegetarians. They aren't immune. It's not a medical book. He may have written a diet book. I am very clear in my words. I don't mix words. And Dean Ornish, whatever his name is, may be very famous. I don't know him. I'm hearing him for the first time. I don't know. I yet ask him to prove and check whether that book is referred as a textbook. Not as a medical book, a text medical book in a college. That shows authenticity. He said, we should not worry about the cattle. Nature will take care. It is you all who are so much worrying. We aren't worrying. Nature made them in such a way that the moment you kill them, they will again come. God is the creator. Allah made them. If we kill lion, tiger, they will become extinct. Therefore, we cannot have their food. The cattle, we can have. God has made them that way. If we don't follow the instruction of God, there will be overpopulation. And regarding cutting of plants, what he said, you know, people say that if you have plants, the mother is yet alive. So in that way, the offspring of the cow, of the goat, the calves, that means can we cut them? Yes. The mother is yet alive. The cow is yet alive. And when the offspring becomes a mother, you can also kill the mother. So even if I agree with this logic, the plant survives. In the animals, more lives are surviving than the plants, if I agree with this logic. Furthermore, I said that best is prevention is better than cure. I agree with Dr. Ornish when he says that, you know, vegetarian diet is helpful for certain diseases. Even I advise that. Where did I say no? But the topic is not which food is healthier. But making a statement, it is banned for human beings. I challenge any authentic medical book. I'm a doctor, not books, whether given by Russia Foundation or Indian Vegetarian Congress, whatever it is. These books are stating things which are unfound, ill-tested, unproved. There is the Islamic method of prevention better than cure, which will answer most of your questions. The Islamic method is there of prevention better than cure. When we slaughter the animal, we do the zabiha. We cut the throat and the windpipe and the vessels of the neck without damaging the spinal cord. Otherwise, the nerve going to the heart may get severed. There may be cardiac arrest. When the spinal cord is not damaged and the vessels of the neck are slit open along with the throat and the windpipe, the heart is pumping. Most of the blood flows out of the body. Blood is a very good media of germ and bacteria. If you slaughter the animal in this way, most of the disease transmitted by blood, many which you named, can be eliminated, can be prevented. The meat remains fresh for a longer time if it's slaughtered with the Islamic method. And people say, oh, it's so merciless. No, you all are so mercilessly killing, it dies of pain. When we slaughter in the Islamic method, when we cut the blood vessels of the neck, the blood supply going to the nerve, which is responsible for pain, is severed.
So the animal does not feel pain. The animal kicks and writhes. You know why? Due to the gush of flow. The animal doesn't feel pain. It is contracting and relaxing because there's lack of blood in that part of the body. The animal does not die of pain. It dies a painless death. Painless. Painless. We eliminate most of the disease transmitted by blood. Secondly, there are many countries in the world and many people who raise animals. They give them hormones. And one was mentioned by Mr. Zaveri, the name. It's called as DES, diacetylbisterol. It's a hormone injected to cattle so that they become fat and you get more money for flesh. This is haram in Islam. Carcinogenic hormones. If ingested in animal, even if you slaughter by the Zabiya method, it is yet haram. It is Zabiya but not halal. It is Zabiya and haram. If the cattle are injected with hormones, you are not allowed to have those hormones. Neither are we allowed to have cows which are fed with non-veg. Because the Prophet said, any animal that is fed with non-veg, it is prohibited for you. After that, if you take care of hygienic conditions and cook the meat very well, most of the diseases which Mr. Zaveri spoke of, not all, most of them will be eliminated. And in the non-veg flesh food, the most dangerous, which is commonly eaten, is pork. It has more than 70 different diseases which you can get if you ingest pork. More than 70 different diseases. And is ischemic heart disease, which he spoke about. Because pork has more of fat building material than muscle building material, it gets deposited on the walls of the vessels, causing atherosclerosis, hypertension, etc. That's the reason in the Quran, no less than four different places, in Surah Baqarah chapter number 2 verse number 173, in Surah Maidah chapter number 5 verse number 3, in Surah An'am chapter number 6 verse number 145, and Surah Nahl chapter number 16 verse number 115, it says, حُرِّمَتْ عَلَيْكُمُ الْمَيْتُتُ وَالْدَّمُ وَلَحْمُ الْخِنْزِيرِ وَمَا أُهِلَّا لِغَيْرِ اللَّهِ بِهِ. Forbidden for you for food are dead meat, blood, the flesh of swine, and any food on which any name besides God's name has been invoked. It's haram. So we abstain from it and we prevent several diseases of non-veg. Quran says in Surah Taha, chapter number 20, verse number 81, eat of the food we have provided for you in sustenance, but commit no excesses therein. Most of the diseases, what Mr. Rashmi Bhai Zaveri spoke about, is due to excessive eating. Even if you eat excessive veg food, you will have many diseases. I will not say, don't have veg food. I'm a doctor. I'm not an ideological, neither a fanatic non-vegetarian. So if you prevent eating in excess, most of the disease will be prevented. If you follow the Islamic guidelines, slaughter in the Islamic method, remove the blood, don't give hormones, cook the food very well, hygienic conditions, avoid pork, don't eat in excess, most of the disease can be prevented. It answers most of his arguments. Few are yet remaining. If time permits or during question answer time, if you ask, I will reply. Do you know that talking about healthy food, talking about all research and experiments, I'll talk something which is a fact. According to Dr. William, again, very famous person, Dr. William, he says that vegetarian food extends the life of a human being for more than 6 years. If you have veg food, as compared to non-veg food, you will live 6 years longer. Again, hypothesis. Hypothesis. If you analyze, a data was collected about all the people who lived above 100 years from 1932 to 1952. And on this data, a person by the name of O. Sijares, he wrote a book, Living to be 100, 1,200 people who did and why they did it. Everything is mentioned. In it, even diet is mentioned. Do you know out of 1,200 people, how many were vegetarian? How many? Yes. 1,000. Four. This survey wasn't done to prove veg food or non-veg food. It was done for other reasons. But even the diet was mentioned. It's a fact. It's not a research. It's a fact. Out of 1,200 people who lived in the span of 20 years, over 100 years, only four were vegetarian. You know alcohol? Alcohol alone. It is a veg diet or not. Alcohol is veg or non-veg? Veg. From juices or fruits. And the disease that are caused by alcohol alone is more than all the non-veg disease put together.
one vegetable that. So just for alcohol, I cannot say that all vegetable foods should be banned. Today, scientists, and he'll agree, it's mentioned in these books also, the cause of maximum death in the world today is alcohol, number one. So I don't ban all veg food. What do I say? As Quran says, Surah Maidah, chapter number 5, verse number 90. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, innamal khamru wal maisuru, wal anzabu wal aslamu, rijsum min amali shaitan, fastanibu lakum tuflihun. That, oh, you believe? Verily, intoxicants and gambling, and idol worship, and dedication of stones, and the emanation of arrows, these are Satan's handiwork. Abstain from it that you may prosper. Alcohol is a Satan's handiwork, abstain from it. Only prohibit alcohol, not all veg food. And smoking, second greatest cause of death in the world. Veg or non-veg? Veg. Can you prevent the alcoholic disease? Only way you can prevent is de-fermented. It ceases to be alcohol. Can you prevent smoking disease? Don't have tobacco. Only option is prohibition. If there is no prevention, then comes the question of prohibition. So alcohol is prohibited. There are more than 400 fatwas by Islamic scholars. Smoking is prohibited because there is no prevention. You know Kesari Dal? Kesari Dal? Indian government has banned it. It causes spastic paraplegia. Staple food of Northwest Indians. Banned. Why? It causes death also. Spastic paraplegia. Alcohol. Many countries have banned, including Saudi Arabia, including states in India have banned it. Smoking in Singapore is banned in public places, in government places, in public transport. Kesari Dal banned by India. If there's no prevention, then you can ban it. I do not know of a single government that has banned all non-veg food in general. Not a single. Yes, few non-veg food, like pork, Saudi Arabia has banned. There's no prevention, banned it. If there's no prevention, then you prohibit it. And the debate was not which is better, which is healthier, veg or non-veg. The debate was, is non-veg food permitted or prohibited? I gave a list of more than 20 points. So I can very well say that Mr. Rashmi Vaidaveri conveniently stopped this talk 5 minutes before, not to answer these things. If you give me 1 hour more, I will continue speaking. Wild berries, they're poisonous. Strychnine, vegetable food, they're poisonous. Datura, poisonous. What's the solution? Don't have it. You know, water. Water has so many diseases transmitted. Cholera, paratyphoid, typhoid. It causes amoebiasis, giardiasis, roundworm, pinworm, vile hepatitis. I can go on talking. Only by water. What do you do? Do you ban water? You prevent it. You purify the water. The disease will be prevented. You know milk. Milk has so many diseases. Shigella, cholera, paratyphoid, typhoid, tuberculosis, salmonellosis, brucellosis. I can go on listing. What do you do? Do you ban milk? What do? You pasteurize it. You don't ban it. You don't prohibit it. It's unmedical. Whether milk is non-veg or veg is a debatable topic. I won't argue on that. So if you cannot prevent the disease, then do you prohibit it? I have given various reasons, which Mr. Rashmi Vaidaveri hasn't replied. There's not a single government who has banned non-veg food in general. There's not a single major religion which has banned non-veg food in general. Therefore, I say that non-veg food is permitted, not prohibited. If I've heard the feelings of any vegetarians while giving the replies to the speaker, I sincerely apologize from the bottom of my heart. I would like to end the talk by giving the quotation of the glorious Quran from Surah Isra, chapter number 17, verse number 81, which says, وَقُلْ جَعَ الْحَقُّ وَزَاكَ الْبَاطِلِ إِنَّ الْبَاطِلَ كَانَ زَهُكَ. When truth is heard against falsehood, falsehood perishes. For falsehood is by its nature bound to perish. وَآخْرُ دَعْوَانَ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ.